Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A History of American Higher Education, 3rd Edition, by John R. Thelin. Narrated by Sean Runnette. Publisher's note, this audiobook refers to figures included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Preface. A journalist, after completing a nationwide tour of American campuses, noted, "At every one of the 14 universities I visited, I was met with the remark, 'You have come to us at a critical moment. This university is just now in a transition stage.'" It's a statement that resonates with the uncertainties and changes that college and university presidents face in 2011. What may be surprising to contemporary listeners is that the remark was made a century earlier, in 1910, by Edwin Slosson when he was finishing the fieldwork for his classic anthology, Great American Universities. Whether 1910 or 2019, an element of continuity is that our colleges and universities are constantly changing, both by accident and design. The temptation is for each generation of academic leaders to consider its own time to be the critical juncture. This historical myopia is especially evident to me when the crises of today are seen as surpassing those of an earlier period, especially in the recent past, such as 1981. One needs historical context to counter the egocentrism of present college and university presidents. As one who has been a faculty member and administrator at both endpoints in this more than 30-year span, my best estimate is that one reason the problems of 1981 seem manageable, perhaps even quaint, today, is that colleges and universities survived a severe storm of financial and political problems, thanks to some remarkable displays of imaginative adjustment, academic soul-searching, and sound educational thinking. How bad were the good old days? The years 1978 to 1981 were a time when the staid Carnegie Commission on Higher Education made the sobering projection that about 25% of American colleges and universities were soon going to cease operation. A historical message, then, is that the problems facing American higher education in the present day are not necessarily unprecedented in their gravity. But this time around, the insights and priorities that might have led academic leaders to good solutions do not seem to be surfacing as well and creatively as they did in 1981. Troubling today is that for those who are seeking to understand and solve the problems now facing colleges and universities, there does not seem to be much inclination to seek genuine historical perspective about higher education as a lens. For example, in November 2010, the Chronicle of Higher Education and Inside Higher Ed reported that Yale University's School of Management was going to work with India's Institute of Management at Kozhikode to train university leaders. The MBA was the model for setting higher education aright. As such, there was little indication that in-depth historical analysis would have an integral part in the kinds of readings and projects associated with an MBA-style curriculum. The problem, and unanswered question then, was what role the history of higher education ought to play in the education of future academic leaders. I resist invoking the academic adage attributed to George Santayana: those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. My hunch is that the real genesis of this bold claim was that a wise, pragmatic senior warned some lazy sophomores, "If you don't study for your History 101 exam, you will fail the course and have to repeat it." That sound advice was not quite as earth-shaking as Santayana's dramatic version. My modest argument is that colleges and universities are historic institutions, and this is a characteristic that warrants careful consideration for those who live, work, and even lead there. Consider, once again, the insights from a century ago, As journalist Edwin Slauson, himself a chemist, observed about the material and physical environment of higher education. But it is impossible to ignore history in dealing with the University of Pennsylvania. One cannot get away from it. All the walls are covered with it. The buildings are genealogical museums. Paintings, bas-reliefs, inscriptions, windows, relics, manuscripts, and similar memorabilia catch the attention of the visitor wherever he goes. Most established American colleges and universities share this legacy of architecture and artifacts. The irony is that often the most unhistorical offices tend to invoke historic motifs. Often it is the main administration building that is home for the relics and paintings, even though few presidents or board members have a deep grasp of the history of higher education. Reasonable doubt about the efficacy of history is kindled as one walks around and through a campus and pays attention to the people and values that are honored in the memorial plaques and naming of buildings. Sitting in the boardroom of a renovated historic administration building, the gallery of presidential portraits often are underwhelming and uninspiring. Why this lackluster impression? Perhaps it is because the patina of heritage wears thin and exposes merely an accumulation of mediocre quality oil paintings of old white guys sitting in high-backed chairs wearing academic gowns with hoods and medallions that bring to mind lodge initiations, rather than serious ideas or excitement about education. The good news is that in recent years, a number of colleges and universities have dared to revisit their heritage with fresh, critical eyes. At Brown University in 2003, the president appointed a broad-based committee of faculty, administrators, and undergraduate and graduate students to investigate the university's history with regard to slavery and the transatlantic slave trade, an exploration that was indelibly linked to the university's namesake, Brown family. This steering committee on justice spent 3 years researching and discussing the complex historical, political, legal, and moral questions posed by any present-day confrontation with past injustice. It led to the creation of a memorial that was no less than a living site of memory, inviting reflection and fresh discovery without provoking paralysis or shame. What was refreshing about this project was that it showed how the history of colleges and universities could be ongoing as a source of both renewal and rediscovery. It provided a welcome alternative to a widespread tendency for institutional histories to avoid or deny controversial episodes, and for present and future generations of the campus community to gain strength and purpose from the informed research and reflection. In a similar vein, there are promising signs that historians who are writing institutional histories are including and addressing characteristics that may today be unflattering. A good example is James Axtell's 2006 The Making of Princeton University, a history that ranged from Woodrow Wilson's presidency up to the early 21st century. Axtell was remarkably candid in noting that the Princeton of Wilson's presidency was intolerant of Jews and other religious minorities, as well as exclusive in its formal and informal restrictions facing women, African Americans, and those from modest income as students, as faculty, and as administrators. Yet the important sequel is that over time, Princeton confronted internally and externally these biases and learned from them, ultimately, and continued changing so that Princeton enhanced both its academic stature and its appropriate commitment to equity and social justice. Brown and Princeton then have provided models for harnessing heritage in ways that are simultaneously thoughtful and useful for present institutional policies and practices. Resurrecting history to face all dimensions of the institutional past will, of course, require initiative and commitment, especially from a president and other academic leaders, in conjunction with grassroots ideas and energy from students and alumni. And although Brown and Princeton have led, by example, in showing how a college or university might replace superficial celebration of the past with a complex, timely presentation of institutional heritage, it will not necessarily be easy for other institutions to follow suit. This is because there are numerous problems facing even those presidents, board members, and alumni groups who wish to keep history vital in higher education. One disturbing development is logistical. Colleges and universities have been losing their institutional memory because dedicated, knowledgeable archivists often now have less and less resources, professional staff, and space for preserving the artifacts and records of campus life, especially in the realm of student culture. The justification for this shift in mission is that in an increasing information age, campus archives have been required to devote increasing time and resources to serve as custodians of official records and institutional files in both electronic and paper form. Meanwhile, photographs, yearbooks, student posters, and publications, sample student term papers, examinations, diaries, and memoirs from recent years have a shrinking space in the institutional memory. The bricks and mortar of colleges and universities are impressive, yet inconsistent in their ability to instill respect for the past. The emphasis on building and expansion is central to American higher education. One journalist noted in 1985 that more than 75% of campus buildings had been constructed in the previous 20 years, leading him to conclude that the true campus symbol for the tumultuous decade of the 1960s wasn't a picket line. It was a construction crane. This building tradition has meant that American colleges and universities are simultaneously major sources of historic preservation and major destroyers of historic buildings, as illustrated by George Washington University, which razed late 18th century row houses to create space for its office, retail, complex enterprise. Transformations in campus architecture are symptomatic of changes and problems in American higher education. A century ago, nationally famous architectural firms competed for the honor of being selected to design and build handsome campus environments. In recent decades, however, the trend has been toward what historian Gay Brecklin called the drift from classical dreams to concrete realities. By the 1950s, campus construction at public universities often was determined by state agency low-bid contract guidelines. Today, campus architecture is large, but often neither inspired nor inspiring. The American campus has become a prisoner of its own success and growth. A century ago, it was praised as a beautiful, amenable place to walk and visit. Today, it is more likely to be about the hardest place for a visitor to find parking, and sometimes so large that students are not able to reach one side of the campus from the other during class breaks. A football stadium and basketball arena used to be built adjacent to one another in the heart of the campus, similar to metropolitan train stations. Illustrative of the transformation of the American campus away from being an integrative, cohesive environment in the 21st century is that campus design is more likely to resemble the logic of airports, with athletic complexes built far away from the campus core. The most disturbing aspect of the historical myopia of American higher education today is the belief by presidents and boards that if only they had more money, then their institutions would be great. Equally plausible is that with more money, the institutions would be merely larger, more complex, and less coherent. When gauged by the standard of the history of higher education from the 17th century to the present, the problems are more those of confused purpose than lack of resources. I gain reinforcement for this view from one of my favorite authors and books, the late Clark Kerr's The Uses of the University. Kerr had no fewer than 5 opportunities to write a new preface in which he could defend or amend the insights he made in his original work. In his final preface, published in 2001, he concluded that American higher education in the 21st century had become uncertain and unclear in its direction and mission. One manifestation of this institutional malaise has been shown during the past decade in the conventional wisdom of college admissions offices, especially at academically selective institutions. Annual increases in college enrollments nationwide have been accompanied by an even greater growth in the number of applications for undergraduate admissions that colleges receive. It is indicative of what has been called application inflation, in which college presidents ascribe to the belief that bigger numbers mean better students. As Eric Hoover has questioned, however, where are the signs that college officials have considered when is enough enough? Evidently, a number of colleges gain reflected glory in their record for denying even highly qualified applicants. It is a syndrome that is commensurate with the research arms race in pursuit of federal grants, pursuits that at some point become counterproductive and dubious in educational propriety. Illustrative of the unfortunate abuses of the syndrome is its encouragement of indulgent consumerism. High school seniors, for example, tend to be encouraged to apply to 10 to 20 undergraduate programs, a behavior made increasingly easy by the availability of internet online common application forms. In addition to inflating and clogging the admissions and selection channels, this collective behavior most likely favors students who already have advantages in terms of college counselors and educated parents. It may help some colleges buoy their statistics and ratios in such rankings as those published by the U.S. News and World Report. On balance, however, it does little to increase genuine access, choice, and affordability to students from underserved constituencies. It represents a peculiar, furtive behavior on the part of established colleges and universities that begs the question of significant educational issues. How should we gauge the most significant historical changes that will have implications for the 21st century? I think that universities, contrary to a stereotype of being stodgy and belatedly mimicking companies and commercial organizations, have often led the way in an organizational transformation that is consequential for American life. The university model, in sum, has been increasingly attractive as a structural and legal arrangement for what once would have been categorized as commercial ventures. The truism used to be, why can't a college be run more like a business? On closer inspection, one finds that pragmatic entrepreneurs have discovered that the smart money opts for a business to be run more like a college, or more specifically, like a university. Often overlooked is that in legal and technical terms, all the designation nonprofit means is that an organization does not offer stocks and dividends to investors. Nonprofit status is relatively silent on matters of compensation and earnings. It is relatively easy to gain status as a 501c3 nonprofit tax-exempt entity. Hence, any enterprise, even remotely related to educational, scientific, and service-oriented activities, has a good chance to qualify as a privileged nonprofit entity. This has certainly been an attractive option for numerous enterprises associated with healthcare services and commercial applications of research and development. To suggest the flexibility of this legal arrangement, one might consider that even the National Collegiate Athletic Association enjoys nonprofit standing, despite its highly lucrative and commercial ventures into broadcasting and spectator sports. As a recent Stanford University study concluded, when it comes to gaining nonprofit status, the American model is that anything goes. The downside has been that universities are less distinctive and less special in how various levels of government treat them. If the institutional conduct in inflating admissions applications were not sufficiently suspect regarding college and university priorities, events of the past decade involving endowments or investments have suggested what truly is a world turned upside down. Or, stated another way, it has been a strange world in which university values about stewardship have been inverted so as to be wrong-headed. Almost 20 years ago, Yale's chief investment officer, David Swensen, wrote the influential book Pioneering Portfolio Management, with the interesting subtitle, An Unconventional Approach to Institutional Investment. According to Andrew Del Banco's 14 May 2009 essay review in the New York Review of Books, Swenson's principal case to his professional academic investment managers was that he had discovered no less than the formula to assure university endowments high yields with low risks. Indeed, this worked. For a while. Perusing the annual editions of the Chronicle of Higher Education's special almanac year by year over the past decade, one does indeed find a 3 or 4 year run in the middle of the decade when numerous universities reported annual enrollment growth of 10%, 15%, and even 20%. But look again. By 2008 and 2009, the double-digit numbers are intact, except that by these years, they had turned from gains to losses. What is ironic in terms of sound academic values is that philanthropy and higher education, including the wise and sound stewardship of endowments, evidently has come to mean in the 21st century that it is imprudent for a university to spend 10% or 15% per year on academic improvement and enhancements to assure quality and affordability for students. Evidently, however, it is all right, or at least understandable and forgivable, for the same institution to lose 10% to 30% on its endowment through risky investment strategies. Are our universities off course in their gyroscope of values and priorities and goals when it is acceptable to lose a large part of the endowment due to greed and risk-taking investments, but off base and spendthrift when investing in the present and future by spending substantially more than the customary, albeit unworthy, limit of 5% spend down per year to solve problems and provide solutions to educational concerns? That is a dilemma of endowments and philanthropy for American higher education in the 21st century that calls out for historical complexity and context to shape present and future deliberations. One imperative for this brand of informed, rigorous self-scrutiny of development and endowment policies is the sobering fact, according to the New York Times in November 2010, that universities will be challenged to reconsider business as usual because donors have retrenched. One reason for this change in giving behavior is evidently due to a loss of confidence in colleges and universities, with the result that donors, especially major donors, ask tougher questions about institutions than they did when they trusted leadership throughout society. The kinds of enterprising organizational behavior founded in missions, fundraising, and endowments have yet another related significant consequence for the blurring line between educational and commercial activities in American higher education. An Achilles heel in large-scale academic research is that the private or commercial sector, as represented by pharmaceutical companies, has been able to evade a great deal of expense and risk. That situation has been allowed to persist because federally sponsored research, usually directed toward university-based research centers, has been well-funded, leaving campus-based scientists to take on the burden of expensive, time-consuming, and precarious basic research. But the indefinite, generous support of campus research has become increasingly uncertain and fragile. Over the long run, this cobbled relationship of corporations and campuses has become harmful, or at least skewed, in that it obligates federal resources to projects that might be directed elsewhere within higher education for other goals. The most troublesome consequence is that these dynamics propel universities to act increasingly as if they were commercial rather than educational institutions. Writing a new, final chapter for a third edition of the book was a welcome task. It was also challenging, because writing history close at hand has peculiar pitfalls. In this case, the recent past, dealing with issues and developments in American higher education since 2010, brings into historical context a concentration of significant issues framed by discussions found in abundant contemporary documents and data. After immersing myself in primary and secondary sources, I came to the observation that the years from about 2010 through 2018 have been, in large measure, opportunity lost for established institutions to anticipate problems. This includes a tendency for many college and university boards and presidents to allow innovations to turn, over time, into imitations. And they have paid dearly for failing to heed storm warnings of deep campus schisms. In contrast to this myopia, some academic constituents have shown remarkable innovation and resilience at the grassroots of teaching and learning, philanthropy, and financial aid, along with numerous programs committed to equity. I hope that the new final chapter, Chapter 10, by focusing on prominence and problems, brings attention to fresh initiatives and unfinished works in progress. Since some who are influential inside and outside colleges and universities have persisted in arguing that higher education should be run like a business, I have taken their message to heart. It has meant that when I undertook writing a new chapter in 2018 for this third edition, my readings and research leaned increasingly toward the economics of higher education. This has included attention to where the money comes from and where it goes, both at the campus level and at the state and federal levels associated with higher education as an enterprise. College and university presidents and their boards of trustees who have emphasized branding and commercialization brought my focus back to activities intended to generate revenues, such as online programs, research parks, product endorsements, and stadium construction. This strategy often has included reliance on big-time intercollegiate athletics as a source of prestige and revenues. When I started writing seriously about college sports as part of American higher education as a graduate student in 1969, I frequently was met with discouraging words on the grounds that the topic was marginal and relatively unimportant. I persisted in writing about the history and economics of college sports for several decades, both as an informed advocate and fair critic. By 2010, I thought I had exhausted the topic and that numerous commissions and panels finally would lead to fundamental reform. I was mistaken on both counts, as intercollegiate athletics has surged in the importance and publicity it engenders in both positive and negative ways. A puzzle for me is why few American colleges or universities have dared to connect image and reality by acknowledging that intercollegiate athletics has become a central mission of the institution. Preoccupation with commercial enterprises and consumerism has perpetuated the belief by leaders that the problems of American colleges and universities are primarily financial ones. An implication is that more money would solve problems and put higher education aright. I have taken this logic into account to analyze the financing of higher education, with emphasis on disparities. I found that some of the most severe cases of scandals, professional misconduct, presidential firings, and uncivil campus behavior have taken place at academic institutions that are well endowed and have abundant revenues. In addition to lack of money, problems facing colleges and universities deal with essential principles and historic commitments. Issues of social justice, equity, educational opportunity, affordability, an inclusive heritage, and education for citizenship are still central in going to college in American life in the 21st century. I have resurrected from 60 years ago the question and challenge posed by John Gardner: can we be equal and excellent too? Gender, race, ethnicity, religion, and social class still call for attention as part of American colleges and universities. In the latest edition of this book, I hope that a combination of serious research, thoughtful listening, and informed discussion will remind a new generation of listeners that history still matters in shaping the appropriate character of American higher education. Introduction: Historians and Higher Education. A beleaguered public relations officer at a White House press conference once fended off a reporter's tough question with the arch quip, "Hey, that's history." The implication was that placing an issue in the historical domain destined it to the dreary insignificance associated with obsolescence. For politicians and journalists, it effectively closed the case. And since American higher education today is a formidable modern enterprise, academic leaders can easily overlook its past. However, my response is markedly different. For me, the discussion of timely higher education topics starts, not stops, with history. Colleges and universities are historical institutions. They may suffer amnesia or have selective recall, but ultimately heritage is the lifeblood of our campuses. I take my cue from a passage in a 1963 Harvard admissions brochure sent out to prospective undergraduate applicants. Its succinct insight was that wealth, like age, does not make a university great, but it helps. That candid observation was bolstered by some thoughtful reflection. The admissions brochure elaborated, "Obviously, age does not guarantee excellence. It may produce simply smug somnolence and hardened arteries. But the university has grown with the country. It has maintained over three centuries an extraordinary vitality and a tough-minded awareness of changing conditions. Its ability to survive and grow strong over these three troubled centuries and its deep roots in the American past have given it an unusual mixture of perspective, confidence, and continuity of purpose." I find this to be a healthy attitude for approaching the history of higher education. In this book, I will introduce the topic by relating some stories that I hope will prompt listeners to think historically about events whose outcomes were neither clear nor certain to the participants when the events were taking place. The aim is to gently upset some conventional notions about how colleges and universities have developed and behaved, especially in such volatile matters as institutional costs and effectiveness, administrations and access, and the character of the curriculum and extracurriculum. This undertaking will mean exhuming forgotten facts and overlooked data to persuade listeners to suspend contemporary notions about academic prestige, as well as academic problems. History does matter. Even the basic facts, names, numbers, and dates, are subject to contemporary confusion and debate. At the inauguration of a college president, institutional representatives usually line up according to the age of their respective institutions, with seniority conferring the privilege of marching at the front of an academic procession. Seldom does anyone in Europe question the right of the delegate from the University of Bologna to lead the procession, because, after all, it was founded in the 13th century. Nor do many representatives from colleges in the United States have the audacity, or ignorance, to step in front of Harvard, with its charter of 1636. After that, however, things get a little more tense when, for example, the delegate from Hampton, Sydney, cuts in line in front of Brown University's representative. How does a historian resolve the dispute as to whether both were chartered in 1764? Consider the recent dispute between two colleges as to which had the right to use a historic name. In 1996, Trenton State College announced that henceforth it would call itself the College of New Jersey. This was the original name for what is now Princeton University. Although Princeton had not used that title for over a century, it filed trademark applications to try to retain rights to the name and strip it from Trenton State College. This was no trifle, as Princeton's vice president for public affairs explained in a letter to the editor of the Chronicle of Higher Education. The only college president to sign the Declaration of Independence was John Witherspoon from the College of New Jersey. The first meeting ever of the New Jersey State Legislature took place 220 years ago this summer on the campus of the College of New Jersey. The only U.S. presidents educated in New Jersey, James Madison and Woodrow Wilson, were students at the College of New Jersey. The first intercollegiate football game was played between two New Jersey teams, including one wearing the orange colors of the College of New Jersey. Much important U.S., New Jersey, and collegiate history took place at the College of New Jersey, so it is not surprising that Trenton State College wishes to wrap itself in that history by taking over a name that for 150 years was the name of what is now Princeton University. We are proud of our history and proud of our original name, and we will do everything we can to prevent someone else from taking it from us. In its efforts to improve quality, we wish Trenton State every success, as we do all other colleges and universities in New Jersey. But we hope the trustees of Trenton State will proceed under a name of their own, not under ours. At a minimum, if they decide to change, let them think about becoming the College for New Jersey, not the College of New Jersey, and leave our history to us. Eventually, the two institutions reached an agreement to allow Trenton State to call itself the College of New Jersey. Soon thereafter, the new College of New Jersey asserted its heritage with a preamble that had Princeton's tone, but fleshed out with different facts. At the College of New Jersey, you will find that traditions are important. The college's history reaches back to 1855. It was established by the state legislature as the normal school, New Jersey's first and the nation's ninth teacher training school. The school flourished in the latter 1800s, and the first baccalaureate program was established in 1925. This change marked the beginning of TCNJ's transition to a four-year college. Each institution had a different story for the same name. Both cases demonstrated that justifiable institutional pride in the past was essential for purpose and confidence in the present. From time to time, presidents and trustees at colleges and universities face pressure from politicians to alter their institutional history because of its potential to contribute to civic or state pride. For example, in 1948, the mayor of Louisville undertook a prolonged campaign to push to relocate the founding of the University of Louisville back to 1798 instead of its conventional date of 1837. He underwrote energetic chronological research in a quest for documents that would confirm his point. According to the university historians, he kept a vertical chart listing the founding dates of the earlier universities, the U of L coming at the end. Then, as his search through the documents enabled him to attain a fresh conclusion, he'd push the position of the U of L a few slots up on the chart and cry out, "We're gaining on them." These examples illustrate that historical writing about higher education is constantly subject to new estimates and reconsiderations. If we find serious disagreements about the names of institutions and their founding dates, then it is reasonable to expect complexity and uncertainty when we try to reconstruct and interpret the most significant issues and episodes of higher education's past. The historian of higher education, then, is both an umpire and an analyst. Given scholarly license and latitude, historical writing can enhance the significance and appeal of contemporary policy issues associated with higher education. My professional passion is to write history for non-historians. The logic, methods, and complexities that historians encounter in reconstructing the past of colleges and universities can inspire, as well as inform, higher education leaders and decision makers. To suggest how fragile some of our contemporary practices and assumptions are, consider, for example, that in the 1890s, Harvard used its medical school as a safe place to admit those sons of wealthy alumni who could not pass the undergraduate college admissions examination. One will not find such data in the official university catalog of the era, for it is a tale told out of school by the eminent Harvard philosopher George Santayana in The Last Puritan, the only novel he ever wrote. If this kind of an anecdote seems to be an aberration and is insufficient to alter our familiar view of academic prestige and positions, I bring attention to an account of faculty deliberations at the University of Pennsylvania in the 1880s. The professors in the established liberal arts college rejected proposals to invite the new departments of history, government, and economics into their ranks. Hence, the rejected departments sought an institutional home elsewhere, namely in the newly founded Wharton School. Unfortunately, historical tensions and debates are often overlooked today as a generation of scholars assume that such seemingly prestigious disciplines and fields have been long established in their familiar settings, when such is not the case at all. Historians can be useful in saving contemporary decision-makers from rushing to judgment about seemingly obvious yet incorrect inferences from documents. For example, one comes across a Life magazine cover photograph featuring screaming, intense Berkeley students. A predictable immediate impression is that of a graphic memento of student unrest, a confirmation of the stereotype of the University of California, Berkeley, as the crucible of strident undergraduate rebellion and demonstrations. This impression might be correct if the Life magazine were from 1968, but this is not the case. In October 1948, the editors of Life focused on Berkeley as the archetypal large state university, with a cover photograph of undergraduates amid a stadium crowd of 70,000 urging their powerhouse California Golden Bears football team to run up the score on the way to a conference championship and a trip to the Rose Bowl. Later in the year, those same students would cheer for their Cal baseball team, which won the NCAA championship by defeating a Yale squad led by first baseman George Bush. In sum, historical documents have complicated our understandings of the complex multiversity. One is then left with the historical puzzle of reconciling the images of Berkeley in both 1948 and 1968 as part of the autobiography of an institution. These selected vignettes at the start of the book are intended to convey the diversity and change in American higher education by suggesting reasonable doubt about the permanence of many present-day policies and practices. The best way for people who analyze higher education, whether as presidents, deans, board members, professors, or concerned parents, to acquire this sense of discovery and fascination with the complexities of their institutional past is to get dirty with data, to work with unwieldy sources and disparate materials in archives and files. The stakes of this charge become higher when college and university presidents invoke historical cases to dramatize contemporary problems. Presidents of state universities lament that their annual appropriations from the state legislature are now inadequate. The typical historical evidence is that state support had been 75% of the university's operating budget in 1910, but had fallen to about 20% in 2000. On close inspection, the logic of this presidential argument is dubious and sometimes disingenuous. A legitimate comparison of past and present campus budgets calls for additional work. First, a cardinal rule among statisticians is that comparing percentages over time without including the actual dollar amounts is incomplete and potentially misleading. Second, the dollars in one era must be indexed for inflation if comparisons with dollars in another era are to be meaningful. And in the case of the state university's budget changes between 1910 and 2000, it's important to add some historical context. The contemporary president is probably hinting that the state government has become stingy. In some states, that might be true. In most states, however, the actual dollar amounts appropriated for the state university have increased each year. A state university in 1910 probably received such a high percentage of state support simply because the numerous other sources of funding we rely on today were either minuscule or non-existent. Federal research and development grants, federal student financial aid transfers, alumni fund contributions, interest from large endowments, and major private donations have all been added to the university operating budget in recent decades. Furthermore, most accounts of the financing of higher education in 1910 indicate that state university presidents considered their governors and legislators to be both frugal and unpredictable. Teaching loads were relatively heavy, and few state universities provided much in the way of sophisticated laboratories, libraries, or resources for doctoral programs. The residual point is that in American higher education, nostalgia for the past needs to be tempered with some careful analyses. What started out as an obvious comparison of higher education's past and present finances has turned out to be a thorny, complex issue that resists simplistic judgment. In 1968, sociologists Christopher Jenks and David Reisman noted in their introduction to their remarkable book, The Academic Revolution, that serious writing and systematic research about higher education had surged since about 1960. They recalled, "When we began studying higher education more than a decade ago, the number of scholars in the field was small enough that we could know almost all of them personally and keep up a correspondence with them. Today, this is no longer possible. Even keeping up with published reports is a full-time occupation, especially if one defines the problem to include not only higher education, but its relationship to American society." This proliferation of scholarship about colleges and universities has continued over the past three decades. Given this remarkable energy, one aim of my book is to bring together the fresh research by historians who, since about 1970, have made interesting contributions to our understanding of higher education. Heretofore, these works may not have always been acknowledged as part of the broad interpretation of American higher education. Hence, the account I present relies greatly on a synthesis of articles, books, and monographs by dozens of established historians. In particular, I owe a debt to Frederick Rudolph for his 1962 classic, The American College and University, A History. My book is, in essence, an attempt to acknowledge Rudolph's work, not in the sense of being an imitation, but rather in an effort to try my own hand and to carry out some suggestions made in the introductory essay I wrote in 1990 as part of a reissue of his influential book. The need for a new book now is twofold. Rudolph's 1962 classic work has some limits. First, it stops with coverage around 1960. And we now have more than four decades of additional events and episodes that call for incorporation into our historical analysis, not just as current events. The same characterization holds true for the exemplary two-volume anthology of primary sources and documentary history that Richard Hofstadter and William Smith edited in 1961. Second, and perhaps most difficult to fuse into the higher education memory, is that since 1960 there has been an interesting, often underappreciated flow of historical scholarship, not just analyzing events since 1960, but rather dealing with the entire history of higher education. These works and their authors have not been fully acknowledged or incorporated into an overarching synthesis. I hope this book redresses that imbalance. Frederick Rudolph's classic work devotes most of its attention to established colleges and universities. My account extends the domain to include analysis of the historical significance of other understudied institutions, such as community colleges, women's colleges, and the historically black campuses. I also try to give some discussion to proprietary schools and freestanding professional colleges. These campuses, whether familiar or understudied, are all part of what I call vertical history, because they are the familiar landmarks that stand upright in our institutional consciousness. I also try to expand the perspective so as to bring explicit attention to what I call horizontal history, the founding and influence of institutions and agencies that cut horizontally across the higher education landscape. These include private foundations, government agencies, and regional boards. The horizontal perspective is a lens that is especially crucial to understanding the interplay between organized philanthropy and higher education. It also provides a good way to integrate a history of public policies with one of colleges and universities. This important addition acknowledges the role of external government programs at local, state, and federal levels that had significance for higher education institutions. My approach to writing a history of American higher education emphasizes the notion of the organizational saga, a term drawn from sociologist Burton Clark's influential analysis of distinctive colleges in the early 1970s. By saga, I mean the proposition that institutions are heirs to various historical strands. On one level, there is the official chronology, as presented in board meetings and formal documents. At the same time, other constituencies transmit the embellished history associated with legends, lore, and heroic events. This history includes the informal yet powerful memories of students, quite apart from official documents or accounts. For example, there is no formal record to confirm that in 1819 Daniel Webster tearfully said to the Supreme Court about Dartmouth, "It is, sir, but a small college, and yet there are those who love it." Despite this lack of formal documentation, the embellished account has had an enduring, powerful impact on how Americans think about colleges as historic, special places. It is a strand of institutional memory that warrants inclusion in any substantive historical account. Architecture is essential for capturing and conveying the historical motifs that each campus projects via its monuments and memorials. 40 years ago, historian Alan Nevins described the importance of campus architecture for institutional saga. One of the more difficult obligations of these new institutions has been the creation of an atmosphere, a tradition, a sense of the past which might play as important a part in the education of sensitive students as any other influence. This requires time, sustained attention to cultural values, and the special beauties of landscape and architecture. This spiritual grace the state universities cannot acquire quickly, but they have been gaining it. Understanding the role of architecture sometimes means paying attention to buildings apart from the conspicuous great campus construction of bell towers and arches. For example, a university's historical saga often depends on certain shrines for enduring inspiration, not because they are magnificent architecture, but rather because they are hallowed ground of important events. So although Stanford University includes the impressive Mediterranean Revival Chapel that the founders had built in honor of their son and the institution's namesake, the complete institutional saga must also celebrate the modest rented garage near the campus where in the late 1930s two young Stanford alumni, William Hewlett and David Packard, worked out their innovations in electrical engineering that ultimately helped to spawn the computer industry of Northern California's Silicon Valley. My approach is to consider key historical episodes that have enduring implications for colleges and universities. Emphasis will be on the social, political, and economic factors that have shaped the structure and life of higher education institutions. So along with acquiring background on institutional histories, the listener will gain experience in making sense out of a range of historical documents and data. The intent is not to train expert historians, but rather to provide non-historians with at least a sampling of the problems and pleasures associated with attempts to reconcile information from the past and the present. The text will draw from secondary sources and scholarly research. It will also rely on primary materials such as institutional records, biography, fiction, memoirs, legends, lore, photographs, monuments, journalism, government reports, statistical summaries, and Hollywood movies to try to reconstruct the issues and debates that comprise higher education's interesting and significant past. My reliance on fiction and memoirs about college life coexists with an equally strong interest in the use and abuse of historical statistics about higher education. In 1984, I wrote an article on cliometrics for a quantitative research journal, Research in Higher Education. I want to revive and expand a theme I developed in that article, namely to provide alternatives to dubious examples of historical analysis stemming from sloppy statistics. I found, for example, that most institutional annual reports on enrollments and budgets were flawed, and that such economists as Seymour Harris often took the data at face value. I want to acknowledge the contributions of such works as Colin Burke's remarkable 1982 study, in which his reconsideration of fundamental data on college founding dates has prompted a dramatically new view of the health of institutions in the early 19th century. I also wish to bring a new generation of listeners to consider such underappreciated works as Marjorie Summers Foster's 1962 Economic History of Harvard College in the Colonial Era. My hope is to encourage contemporary scholars to undertake fresh analysis of historical statistics, especially in the economics of higher education and in the enrollment and retention patterns of students at colleges and universities. To accomplish this, I have presented financial data in two ways. First, in the actual dollar amounts reported in documents at the time, and second, in figures adjusted to account for inflation. Even this procedure requires a caveat. Making sense out of finances from a past era ultimately must be grounded in an understanding of the circumstances of economic and social customs of each historical period. A thoughtful economist who compares college tuition charges of 1800 with those of 2000 might also ask probing questions about purchasing power, foregone income, and reliance on barter and exchanges of goods and services other than currency. This is the attention to detail that makes the history of higher education simultaneously complicated and interesting. No author can succeed at narrating a wholly comprehensive chronology of American higher education in a single, concise volume. My interpretation is admittedly selective, nor do I think trying to present all the facts and dates about colleges and universities is even a desirable goal for most listeners. Instead of emphasizing mastery of information, my aim is to promote an interest in and appreciation for working with documents and secondary sources. I hope this relatively concise work about a long sweep of time will show how historical analysis of higher education may be transformed from a passive spectator sport into an active intellectual pursuit. The varieties of records about institutional heritage, including the numerous versions that are written and rewritten by new generations and multiple audiences, hold out the promise of American higher education's lively, enjoyable past. 1. Colleges in the Colonial Era. Colleges and the Colonial Revival. The historic colleges founded in the colonial era enjoy a special place in our national memory. Our oldest corporation, for example, is Harvard College, not a commercial business. Not only are these colleges old, they are also influential and vivid in the American imagination. When President Dwight D. Eisenhower visited the Dartmouth campus in 1953, he exclaimed, "Why, this is how I always thought a college should look." Most Americans understood his response and shared his sentiment. Red brick Georgian buildings with slate roofs, white trim, and mullioned windows, clustered around a green, provided an academic archetype indelibly linked with a real and imagined colonial past. This presence today meant that the surviving colleges, founded before 1781, familiar today as Harvard, William & Mary, Yale, Princeton, Columbia, Brown, Dartmouth, Rutgers, and Pennsylvania, stand out as institutions that have acquired prestige along with longevity. Their oldest buildings, including Princeton's Nassau Hall, Brown's University Hall, Harvard's Massachusetts Hall, Yale's Connecticut Hall, and the Wren Building at William & Mary, have become monuments that convey dignity and command respect. These buildings ascend to the status of national shrines because early on, their academic operations were heroically fused with the larger events of social and political history. Their space was transformed dramatically to play a central role in the American campaign for independence. Classrooms became sites of legendary patriotic oratory, and dormitories were pressed into service as hospitals and barracks for troops during the Revolutionary War. As one Alumni Society's bumper sticker proclaimed in 1981, they were the alma mater of a nation. The obvious prestige that the colonial heritage gives to these colleges today, however, has been neither inevitable nor unbroken. The historic colleges themselves had, from time to time, been indifferent to connections between their past and present. In other words, it has only been since around 1890 or 1900 that the colleges founded in the colonial era rediscovered and then asserted this legacy as part of their contemporary educational mission and appeal. Once again, the architectural record provides a good clue to this change. Most of their original buildings from the 17th and 18th centuries had either been torn down or destroyed by fire. Those that survived into the 19th century were in disrepair. Many of their original design elements became hidden over the years, as college officials, for example, added a porch in the 1850s or plastered over windows in the 1870s. Photographs of the academic building at the College of William and Mary from as late as 1925 show the original college edifice, constructed in 1695, with plaster crumbling, electrical cords dangling from the ceiling, and window frames rudely covered by either brick or plywood. The important element of the colonial success story is that between 1890 and 1960, Americans, including officials at the old colleges, rediscovered and then revitalized their colonial heritage. The momentum was provided in part by the centennial celebration of 1876, and by 1890 it had gained formal status with the creation of such organizations as the Daughters of the American Revolution. In numerous cities and states along the Atlantic coast, voluntary associations formed groups dedicated to preserving antiquities, and the old colleges benefited from this movement, which energetically combined historical preservation, ancestor worship, and patriotism. Renovating the handful of surviving 17th and 18th century college structures was the first step, with attention to sprucing up the neglected sites. And the preservation ethos dictated that this was to be done so as to convey some approximation of allegedly authentic historic forms and colors. The growing fascination with and respect for the colonial connection surfaced in other visual forms, too. When Brown University, for example, celebrated its sesquicentennial in 1914, its official poster depicted a thoughtful colonial gentleman in a tricorn hat kneeling next to a modern scholar wearing a mortarboard and academic gown. Resurrection of colonial motifs as part of academic strategy gained appeal elsewhere. In Williamsburg, Virginia, the college campus benefited from the colonial restoration, sponsored by the Rockefeller families starting in the late 1920s. Not only was the academic building restored, there was also a commensurate restoration of ceremonies and rituals as students and administrators increasingly emphasized colonial roots in college publications and public events. Festive colonial costume balls were initiated, as well as such solemn events as Charter Day, with readings from the original college documents. Before the 1930s, catalogs, diplomas, and library stamps had shown little connection with historic names and often referred to the institution as William and Mary College. But now names and titles were codified and standardized to reflect a distinguished past. Henceforth, the institution would be known as the College of William and Mary in Virginia. The official language on diplomas took the historicism an additional step. Deference to the real and imagined classical curriculum of the 18th century meant that the 20th century parchment would carry the name Collegium Guillamus et Marius, even though the study of Latin had long ceased to be a requirement for the bachelor's degree. At the College of William and Mary, revitalized historic pride also displayed itself in the name and tone of the student yearbook, the Colonial Echo. Editors of the 1936 edition showed their admiration for the founding fathers by using 17th century typefaces and spelling in a volume in which ye editors attempt to intensify the reverberations of the glorious past of the college. The college president reinforced the spirit of the student project as he noted in his preface to the yearbook, like a great artery, throbbing and pulsing from the heart of life, the aims, the obligations, the courage, and the will of 1693 animate the William and Mary of 1936. Indeed, 1936 was a very good year for colonial celebration. At the same time that William and Mary was echoing its 17th century heritage, to the north, in Massachusetts, Harvard was celebrating its 300th anniversary with a year-long slate of academic ceremonies, special events, and guest speakers. At all the historic colleges, officials began to update their admissions brochures and view books so as to draw increasing attention to an account of founding, of struggle and perseverance, a mix of heroic events and legendary figures. Why is it important to delineate this colonial revivalism as part of the college's self-characterization in the 20th century? First, one must bear in mind that invoking an inspired colonial heritage had become potent, but had not always been so. For example, in 1888, representatives of William and Mary urged Virginia's legislators to fund this historic institution that had fallen on hard times. Surely the legislature would recognize its duty to help the college reclaim its original colonial commitment to the liberal education of future leaders. This historical imperative might have been self-evident to the college representatives, but they were surprised to find that their campaign held little appeal to the Virginia General Assembly. Legislators ignored the case for colonial resurrection and instead opted to provide annual subsidies so that the historic college could tend to the immediate and modern problem of educating a cohort of white male schoolteachers to staff the state's emerging public school system. 50 years later, though, invoking a colonial legacy would become effective in both academic fundraising and admissions. A second reason to consider closely the historic colleges as part of a larger movement of colonial revivalism is that the movement fostered levels of academic honor and imitation. Brown University reminded prospective students of its heritage with the following reminder in its 1956 admissions brochure. Brown is an old institution, older actually than the nation itself, and it derives great strength from its rich tradition and heritage. There is a distinctive flavor about very old colleges, something that comes from vast experience, from the durability of ancient ideas and ideals, from a spirit that has persisted long before the memory of living man, and even from the ivy which climbs the walls. Colleges and universities of all ages and types across the United States acknowledged this heritage and often attempted to incorporate it into their own ethos. The American public, as well as academics, has subscribed to this characterization of colonial tradition as a source of educational excellence. When the historic colleges banded together to form an Ivy League athletics conference in 1956, the group was nicknamed the Ancient Eight by sports writers. Jumping from the popular activities of spectator sports to movies, one finds a comparable awareness of collegiate heritage among Hollywood studio executives. In 1934, a movie director insisted on sending an entire film crew from Los Angeles to New England to shoot scenes of college life. When asked to justify the inordinate time and expense involved, he said, bluntly, "I want the richness, the fine old atmosphere of the Ivy League." A good example of this revivalism and emulation took place at Miami University of Ohio. The university's splendid Markham Conference Center combines a 20th century interior and amenities with an exterior that reproduces the Wren building of the College of William and Mary. Even the historic colleges themselves followed the formula of colonial revivalism. For example, Thomas Mott Shaw, one of the primary architects of the colonial Williamsburg town restoration, also designed new residential quadrangles at Brown University. In 1934, William and Mary replaced a nondescript field with a colonial-style sunken garden to complement its newly renovated Wren building. By the time Harvard was ready to celebrate its tercentennial in 1936, it had completed an extensive neo-Georgian environment, relying on the architectural firm of Coolidge, Shepley, Bullfinch, and Abbott to create its new residential house system, which would accommodate over 3,500 undergraduates. Here, as at other historic colleges, it was not sufficient merely to renovate existing buildings. When new construction was required, even it had to look old. Exhuming and examining the glorious past. Although campus visitors and yearbook editors may have been satisfied with the atmosphere and imagery of the glorious past projected by the colonial colleges, the revivalism movement merely starts our historical inquiry. Monuments and motifs are important, but they are only one layer of historical analysis. The challenge here is to use the colonial celebration as the lens through which to look critically and closely at the substance of these institutions founded prior to the Revolutionary War. The first research question the colonial revival colleges raise is, what were the distinctive features and contributions of these colleges that make them central to the American heritage? Reconstructing the collegiate past gets increasingly complicated when this question coincides with another finding. The attraction of the early American colleges is in part due to their historic association with England. For example, a recent guide to Harvard's architecture described Holden Chapel, built in 1744, as a Georgian gem that stands out as a solitary English daisy in a field of Yankee dandelions. When academic leaders at William and Mary completed their historic college building, they called it the Sir Christopher Wren Building, even though there was no record that the great English architect had anything to do with its construction or that his name was ever used to describe it in the 17th and 18th centuries. So we are left with the reminder that American heritage included a formidable strand of Anglophilia. It was, after all, a colonial region that included a self-proclaimed New England. Anglophilia is a recurring theme in the history of American higher education. One important interpretation is that the distinction and success of the colonial colleges was associated with their having transplanted the Oxford-Cambridge ideal to America. This was the intriguing argument made by historian Frederick Rudolph in his classic account of the Collegiate Way. It is also a theme often presented by the colleges themselves today. In 1963, Harvard College described the legacy as follows. Students lived together in the college building in constant contact with their teachers. They worked and played together, creating the very special kind of community which has been characteristic of the American residential college ever since. American colleges, following Harvard's early example, have adopted the Cambridge-Oxford pattern rather than that of the continental universities. The late George W. Pearson, longtime historian of Yale, summed up the legacy with this account of the college system. Another essential in Yale's code from the start was the collegiate ideal. That is, young men should eat, sleep, study, play, and worship together, make friends, compete against each other, and learn to stand on their own two feet in loyalty always to the larger community. As at Oxford and Cambridge, books were to be but a part of the education. Or as Yale's younger Timothy Dwight, 1886-99, would insist, the truth can be but dimly seen by the intellect alone. Whatever the present differences of opinion on this matter, the historic fact is that from the earliest times the college had tried to keep all of its students together, and the youthful society thus formed had promptly and enthusiastically set to work to create its own system of self-improvement, a second or social curriculum. This intriguing interpretation, persistently presented by a formidable group of college historians, however, is not the whole story. In order to understand precisely what was being praised and invoked as the model for the American colonial colleges, It is useful to reconstruct the character and condition of Oxford and Cambridge in the 17th and 18th centuries. Oxford and Cambridge in perspective. It is true that the collegiate system of mixing living and learning was at the heart of the Oxford and Cambridge pedagogy, and this vision was seminal in the plan for higher education that college founders pursued in the American colonies. Equally true, however, was that Oxford and Cambridge were distinctive in their governance and formal legal structures. This unique arrangement was that the colleges were privately endowed, relatively autonomous units that were linked in a federation. In short, the 12 or so residential colleges of 18th century Oxford and Cambridge were the famous sites of student learning and living. College names including Balliol, Trinity, Clare, Caius, Pembroke, Emmanuel, Magdalen, Oriel, and Christchurch were the primary sources of affiliation for students and faculty alike. The overarching structure, the university, was the degree-granting entity, defined and protected by a royal charter. At Oxford and Cambridge, students may have had their academic instruction and extracurricular activities centered in their respective colleges, but it was the university that conducted examinations and awarded degrees. Why is this important? First, the American colonial colleges fused instruction with certification, a practice wholly alien to Oxford and Cambridge. Second, Oxford and Cambridge were remarkable in that within each university, there was a honeycomb network of colleges, each with its own heritage, tradition, funding, and emphases. According to Cambridge University's historical brochures, by 1596, it included 16 endowed colleges, and the founders of colleges were various, but all were extremely wealthy. In contrast, no American institution ever went beyond providing a single college, and founding donations were modest when measured against the standards of benefactions for England's universities. America's colleges took a long time, more than two centuries, to match the appearance of Oxford and Cambridge. Construction of the Harvard houses and the Yale colleges in the 1930s was a belated architectural fulfillment of this collegiate ideal. Architecture is also a useful approach to reconstructing the colonial colleges because the surviving buildings graphically display both the strengths and the limits of the Oxford-Cambridge model in America. The defining form for the Oxford and Cambridge educational and collegiate system was the quadrangle, an enclosed, total institution with a courtyard or grassy interior. The historic colonial academic buildings, for all their grandeur, also demonstrated the limits of transplanting England's academic architecture to the New World. Each building was, at the time of its construction, probably the largest, most expensive structure in its host colony. At the same time, neither the architecture nor the pedagogy could completely replicate the Oxford-Cambridge ideal. In most cases, the colleges ran out of money before they could complete the construction of a planned quadrangle that would extend behind and around the main building to create the total environment for living and learning associated with the collegiate way. King's College, now Columbia University in New York City, first used Trinity Church Schoolhouse for its instruction. There is no compelling evidence of plans for elaborate construction of quadrangles. In Philadelphia, local fundraising was intended to pay for what was called New Building, a large preaching hall and charity school. Work on this monumental structure, hailed as the city's largest building, was suspended first for lack of money and later for hospital and military operations during the Revolutionary War. Even from its origin, it carried out the distinctive educational ideas and plans of Benjamin Franklin, who hardly sought to emulate the English residential college curricular scheme. Reservations about the extent to which the colonial academics sought to create truly residential collegiate environments are found in Virginia. The early statutes for William and Mary explicitly stated that students who were paying their bills were not required to live at the college. We leave their parents and guardians at liberty whether they shall lodge and eat within the college or elsewhere in the town or any country village near the town. For it being our intention that the youth, with as little change as they can, should learn the learned languages and the other liberal arts and sciences. If any have their houses so near the college that from thence the college bells can be heard and the public hours of study be duly observed, we would not by these statutes hinder them from boarding their own children or their friends or from lodging them at their own houses. Adaptation to scarcity was part of the story. Running out of money was a pervasive problem, but not the only factor. Even if the New World College founders had acquired additional resources, they would not necessarily have considered Oxford's architecture of the 18th century to be a very pleasing model. Accounts from England indicate a great deal of self-indulgent, ostentatious building at the universities. Magnificent stables for gentlemen scholars who brought more horses than books to university was one Oxford contribution. Laboratories and provisions for scientific research were marginal at Oxford, if provided at all. Libraries were built more for the sake of monumental decor than utility. Diaries of university scholars indicate time and time again that for well over a half century, commitment to serious scholarship had ceased to be fashionable among Oxford undergraduates and masters alike. In conclusion, although Oxford and Cambridge influenced and inspired some college founders in America, the British universities also provided some examples of educational practices that the colonists deliberately rejected. The colonial colleges were both more and less than little Oxfords and Cambridges. This general claim about the collegiate way must be tempered by a close look at varieties of historical evidence. First, institutional transplants seldom have been perfect, so for all the invocation of a New England, well-intentioned college builders fell short in their efforts to recreate Cambridge or Oxford in America. Furthermore, the various colonial colleges also embodied indigenous efforts at innovation and reform. In fact, the American colleges of the colonial era were remarkable and complex. A hybrid of legacies, transplants, deliberate plans, and unintended adaptations. As historian James Axtell has argued, the New England colonists aspired to create a school upon the hill, as part of their social ideal of a city upon the hill. The preceding brief profile of 17th and 18th century Oxford and Cambridge has already hinted at some defining characteristics of the colonial colleges. It is a good preface to a detailed consideration of religion, philanthropy, governance, curriculum, and student life up to the Revolutionary War. Governance and structure. Understanding the philosophy and structure of the colonial colleges requires consideration of legacies beyond Oxford and Cambridge. For example, although the residential collegiate way appealed to the New World College founders, they detested the sloth and autonomy of the Oxford scholars. They therefore looked to the Scottish university's reliance on an external board, rather than faculty control, to give legal definition to the college as an incorporated institution. In matters of charters and academic codes, the medieval universities of the continent also had an influence that has often been unappreciated by historians. And given the range of Protestant denominations accommodated within the colonies, one would do well to look at the influence of England's dissenting academies. Institutions of advanced learning founded by Methodists and other groups that were ineligible for royal charters and hence excluded the power to confer degrees. This provision for ultimate control by an external board built in a mechanism for continual accountability. Equally important was the board's vesting the office of the college president with administrative authority. This was a radical departure from academic governance at the historic British universities. In England, the custom had been that the colleges were self-perpetuating associations of faculty, with perhaps some rotational authority given to a master who would be first among equals. The English universities had no strong central administrative officer. Even to this day, it remains an Oxford pastime to try to decipher what precisely, if anything, the Chancellor is expected to do. The American colleges could not have been more different. Whereas Oxford and Cambridge masters had endured and ignored kings, queens, and bishops for centuries, the colonial college faculty faced daily scrutiny by and little indulgence from a stern governing board and its appointed administrators. A president reported to the Board of Trustees or the Board of Visitors, not to the faculty. Reading through the early college statutes and bylaws, one finds other evidence of a systematic effort to confine faculty authority. For example, at one institution, there was official provision for a college senate, but the bylaws defined its membership as being drawn exclusively from the Board of Visitors and college governors, not the faculty. Little wonder, then, that academic freedom and instructors' rights in matters of hiring and firing received minimal consideration. This element in the structure and accountability of the colleges was an innovation that had enduring consequences. One could argue that the creation and refinement of this structure, the external board combined with a strong college president, is a legacy of the colonial colleges that has defined and shaped higher education in the United States to this day. College finances. During an extended period in which colonies were saturated with taxes from the British Crown, it seems remarkable that colonial revenues were used to support the colleges at all. Relative to other civic or public services, each college tended to be blessed with government funding. The General Court of the Massachusetts Bay Colony dedicated 1/4 of the colony's annual tax levy, about £400, to help Harvard College get started. The College of William and Mary, which enjoyed the privilege of a royal charter, was the most abundantly assisted institution, King William having provided almost £2,000 and other subsidies for founding the college in 1693. Either crown or colony provided the colleges with land. In several cases, when founders of a new college grew unhappy with its original site, they considered moving elsewhere. Such cases gave rise to battles between towns, with the host town literally fighting to keep the college in its original place. If persuasion or incentives did not work, townspeople relied on other means. Citizens of Saybrook, Connecticut, unhitched the oxen and broke down some bridges in an effort to block that colony's college from carting its books to New Haven. Meanwhile, rival New Haven offered incentives of land and subsidies to persuade a college to relocate. In New Jersey, the town of New Brunswick lost out to Princeton in the competition to be the home of the Presbyterians' College of New Jersey. This did not deter the New Brunswick contingent, which eventually persuaded the Dutch Reformed church leaders to build their own new Queen's College, now Rutgers, in their town. Bridge tolls, surcharges on licenses, tobacco poundage, lottery proceeds, and gifts of land were among the varied and sundry subsidies colonial governments relied upon for collegiate funding. But if the system and intentions were strong, the actual record of regular support was erratic, and at least from the college's perspective, marginal, if not insufficient. From the start, then, American colleges perpetually depended on tuition payments and donations, as well as subsidies, to operate. The colleges also learned through experience the need for accountability and good record-keeping, particularly as they came to acquire substantial resources. During the Revolutionary War, for example, Harvard's treasurer absconded with college funds, an action that one economic historian has described as disturbing. Religion and the college. Religion occupied a central but confined place in the colonial colleges. Although the New World provided some opportunities for religious freedom not found in England or Europe, it does not follow that the colonies were hospitable to religious tolerance. Rhode Island was an anomaly on two counts. First, its founding by a Baptist put it outside the orbit of not only the Church of England, but even the accepted learned Protestant denominations. Second, its allowance for religious practice by a number of groups was exceptional. This tolerance worked its way into Rhode Island's collegiate charter, with the explicit provision that there shall never be admitted any religious tests, but on the contrary, all members hereof shall forever enjoy full, free, absolute, and uninterrupted liberty of conscience, and that the sectarian differences of opinions shall not make any part of the public and classical instruction. Even this accommodation had strict limits. The colonies were a Christian world, and more accurately, a Protestant world. Well into the 18th century, few colonial governments accommodated Quakers. We find no establishment of a Roman Catholic-affiliated college in the colonies. Judaism did not enter into the discussions, even though college scholars sometimes studied Hebrew. Appointments to the governing board of the Tolerant College of Rhode Island were set by statute to follow a strict formula that limited membership to Baptists, Presbyterians, Congregationalists, and Anglicans. New Jersey, along with Rhode Island, probably the most diverse and tolerant of the colonies, was home to two colleges, the College of New Jersey, founded by and for Presbyterians, and Queen's College, tied closely to the Dutch Reformed denomination. At the College of William and Mary, all masters and scholars were required to take an oath of allegiance to the Crown and to the Church of England. What we find then, especially in the 17th and early 18th centuries, is a precarious balance in which each colony and its college were staked out by followers of a particular Protestant denomination. Was this a theocracy? Contrary to conventional wisdom, it was not. The Massachusetts Bay Colony had restrictions on clergy and government. Harvard College's statutes for appointments to the college's board made a clear distinction between ministers and magistrates. Although divines were influential and powerful figures in the life of the colonies, including the colleges, ordained clergy could not hold government office. Hence, there were some structural checks and balances with respect to clerical power. This provision, however, did not prohibit one religious group from dominating institutions. The college in Connecticut, later renamed Yale, was founded by Congregationalists who had become displeased with what they thought was theological laxity of the Harvard divines. In their new venture as wilderness prophets, they soon faced some bad news. College board members were surprised to discover that their newly selected rector and their one tutor upon whom they had relied to uphold a strict congregational orthodoxy had publicly declared for episcopacy. Anglicans were not welcome in Connecticut or at its college. Illustrating the power of the external board, both the rector and tutor were dismissed immediately, and henceforth all those who were appointed to the faculty were required to subscribe to a confession of congregational orthodoxy. There was an important change in the politics of religion and colleges by the mid-18th century. The aim at some of the newer colleges was to allow some diversity and balance of representation among sects in an effort to keep any single group from gaining hegemony. The original proposal for the creation of King's College in New York had called for it to be an Anglican institution, but by 1753 a group of Presbyterians, many from the nearby College of New Jersey, had effectively blocked this measure. The compromise was that the charter required the King's College president to be Anglican, but its board members were to be drawn from other Protestant denominations, and its admissions requirements showed no favoritism toward any one sect. These episodes and resolutions indicate that within the ranks of colonial colleges, there was no love lost and little tolerance extended between competing denominations. According to historian Jürgen Herbst, the religious disputes in matters of college governance were a result of the proliferation of Protestant denominations, which led to increased diversity within the colonial population, especially in the Middle Atlantic region. Colonial governments tried to avoid social disruption by encouraging denominational tolerance, even in college admission policies. In the mid-18th century, however, this practice broke down when the dominant denomination at a particular college clashed with the varied mix of Methodists, Baptists, and Quakers among students and their parents. Herbst claims that the breakdown of interdenominational tolerance in college governance laid the groundwork for the 19th century trend in which each religious group would seek to found its own colleges. Philanthropy. Philanthropy was closely tied to religion, a partnership of which colleges were major beneficiaries. This partnership worked in several interlocking ways. First, devout donors in New England, who may not have been specifically interested in endowing a college, were nevertheless intrigued by the prospects for missionary work among the American Indians. Such donors were generous in their support of programs designed to provide a Christian education to those they considered to be savages. Colonial colleges were an available, appropriate vehicle to administer such funds and to carry out these charitable programs. Resourceful college officials were adept at gaining permission to implement flexible interpretations of wills and bequests. Perhaps the best illustration of this sort of philanthropic windfall is the estate of the wealthy English chemist Sir Robert Boyle. Boyle's will designated that rents from his estate, the Brafferton, were to be used to support pious and charitable works. The executor of the estate had license to define this directive as including scholarships for Indian students in the wilderness of America, and representatives of two colonial colleges, Harvard and the College of William and Mary, were eager to let the executor know that their colleges were available to help carry out Boyle's charitable wishes. In addition to the scholarship funds, each college also claimed a sum for operating expenses, probably a forerunner to overhead accounts. Later, ingenious college officials argued successfully that the scholarships could also be used to educate colonial students who aspired to become missionary teachers among the Indians. Assessing the motives and measure of early donations is not easy. John Harvard and his fellow Cambridge University alumni, whose early gifts of books and money were crucial to the founding of the college in the Massachusetts Bay Colony, are depicted as devout and serious of purpose. The college's fundraising prospectus indicated that good works, namely support for a college, might help one to a place in heaven. This was not always the only incentive for generosity, as some donors sought and received their rewards immediately on earth. In London, for example, three convicted pirates agreed to give the College of William and Mary a gift worth £300, and in return they were spared the gallows. At best, a college donor could simultaneously gain both perpetual fame and eternal salvation. One fascinating glimpse at the biographical profile of a philanthropist who combined the two goals comes from the epitaph that Elihu Yale wrote to describe himself before his death in 1721. "Born in America, in Europe bred, in Africa traveled, and in Asia wed, where long he lived and thrived, at London dead. Much good, some ill he did, so hopes all even, and that his soul through mercies gone to heaven. You that survive and read, take care for this most certain exit to prepare, for only the actions of the just smell sweet and blossom in the dust." Elihu Yale, described by George Pearson as a London Yankee who had been a nabob in India, gave the financially struggling collegiate school in Connecticut a gift of 9 bales of goods worth about £562, along with 417 books and a portrait and arms of King George I. Although this donation represented only a small part of his mercantile wealth, the college trustees changed the institution's name to Yale College as a sign of both gratitude and hope for additional gifts from this new namesake patron. But much to the college officials' disappointment, Yale's will did not mention the college. Unknown to college representatives at the time, Elihu Yale had never really considered the college to be a primary interest among his numerous projects and philanthropies. Religion also probably played a role. As an Anglican, he had reservations about being a benefactor for a college that represented a dissenting denomination. Donations to support faculty were rare during the colonial period, but there were some landmark episodes. At Harvard in 1721, Thomas Hollis donated money to endow a chair of divinity. This was an important, controversial area of scholarship, and the gift ushered in a classic battle between college and donor over who had the right to define the curriculum and to pick the scholar to occupy the chair. The legacy of this episode of philanthropy was charges on both sides of abuse and self-dealing. The acrimony that the episode generated was fortunately dissipated when Harvard readily accepted and adhered to the conditions of Hollis's later gift to endow a faculty chair in the sciences and mathematics. One can piece together from ledgers and journals the skeletons of college budgets. However, the records are incomplete and misleading. First, currencies varied greatly in their worth. Silver and gold coins from England were worth more than domestic currency of comparable face value. Second, economic historians rely on rough estimates based on comparable worth from one era to another. This strategy runs into problems when an item that might have been essential in the 18th century is in little demand in the 20th. Third, a great deal of a college's income was in the form of country pay, namely, gifts in kind of crops, firewood, or livestock. Before one dismisses such practices as obsolete, it is worthwhile to note that even in the 21st century, the practice of prosperous farmers and ranchers donating livestock for university football team dining halls persists as a generous and welcome custom. The colonial colleges were lean operations. Salaries for most instructors, called tutors, were marginal, often less than the wages for artisans. Professional positions were scarce. The one academic appointment that commanded good compensation was that of college president. The salary was relatively high and was often paid directly from the colonial general courts. The job's perquisites included a house and grazing rights in the college yard for one's cows. Colleges subsisted from year to year and were dependent in part on paying students. However, according to most estimates, charges for tuition plus room and board were relatively modest, and no college could have paid all operating expenses from student fees. When Samuel Johnson wrote an advertisement for the opening of King's College in 1754, he went on eloquently about lofty aims to teach and engage the children to know God and Jesus Christ, and to love and serve Him in all sobriety, godliness, and righteousness of life. Then he closed with the less lofty but very emphatic note, "The charge of the tuition is established by the trustees to be only 25 shillings for each quarter." Another source of income was endowed scholarships for poor but able youth. The colleges seem to have worked hard at keeping tuition low and to have used financial aid to recruit applicants. What is remarkable about the colonial colleges is that they managed to survive despite their lean budgets. This was in part due to their fiscal conservatism and also to the legal protections and occasional subsidies provided by governments of the era. But most of all, they owed their survival to their tireless fundraising efforts. The curriculum. We have few written records to help us reconstruct the colonial curriculum. Each college published admission requirements and usually spelled out the specific classical languages, ancient authors, and levels of mathematics the student was expected to have mastered. Published requirements are one matter, but strict adherence is quite another. Entrance examinations were usually administered verbally by the college president. Since there was no reliable system of primary or secondary education in place, precisely how prospective college students were to gain a preparatory education remained uncertain. Sometimes the colleges simply allowed boys to matriculate, often as young as 14 or 15 years old. Most of the colonial colleges both bent administration requirements and provided preparatory and elementary instruction as a way of gaining revenues and cultivating future student cohorts. As for pedagogy, Students faced a mix of classroom recitations and oral disputations, in which they were subject to immediate critical evaluation by both masters and fellow undergraduates. Often the motivation for a young man to put aside games and indolence in order to study biblical texts, solve mathematical problems, or conjugate Latin verbs was to avoid the jeers that greeted poor public speaking, flawed logic, or faulty translations. The capstone event of the academic year was the series of speeches and disputations presented during commencement week. Varied accounts indicated impressive level of intellectual discourse and critical analysis. One newspaper account of the commencement exercises at King's College in 1758 praised the presentations dealing with such topics as metaphysics. Contemporary science was given a central place, with the audience hearing a treatise on the revolution of the Earth around the Sun that was based on both astronomical observations and the theory of gravity. Although the college had made concessions to the vernacular by allowing disputations to be conducted in English, guardians of standards were reassured to learn that the valedictory oration was in Latin. The program ended with prayers and blessings, reconciling secular learning with Christian faith. The newspaper writer concluded that all was well with the young college and urged citizens to promote so useful, so well-regulated an institution. What the newspaper account did not mention was that in addition to the academic events, commencement exercises were often an occasion for extended celebrations and drinking by both town and gown in the colonial era. The kinds of lectures and presentations that were central to the King's College commencement ceremonies illustrated exciting international developments. At the highest level of their scholarship and pedagogy, the colonial colleges were influenced by the academics at Edinburgh and Glasgow more than by the practices of Oxford or Cambridge. Political oratory, based on classical allusions and sound logic, helped to develop the critical analytic skills that defined political economy as a discipline that would be central to the college education of future statesmen in the New World. There also was a fluidity in the collegiate environment that indicates a breadth of learning and inquiry beyond the formal course of study. Undergraduates, including a young Thomas Jefferson, noted in diaries their lessons and discussions with mentors in such fields as law or even medicine, even though such subjects were not always a central part of the official curriculum. King's College in New York claims to have established a medical school in 1767, but this was an exceptional innovation. The College of Rhode Island was adventurous in its relatively broad intentions for the curriculum. Its charter explicitly stated that the public teaching shall in general respect the sciences. At all the colleges, the young scholars who serve as tutors evidently had interests in learning far beyond the requirements of their formal teaching. From time to time, there is evidence that they pursued on their own studies in natural philosophy, forerunner to our contemporary notion of the physical sciences. One particular characteristic of the colonial colleges in their first decades is that there was little emphasis on completing degrees. Many students matriculated and then left college after a year or two, apparently with none of the stigma we now associate with dropouts. College students probably constituted less than 1% of the population. Enrollments were modest, even in terms of the 18th century population. When the College of Rhode Island opened in 1765, only one student enrolled. 2 years later, the total enrollment was 10. By 1707, Yale College had conferred bachelor's degrees upon a total of 18 students. At the College of William and Mary, so few undergraduates petitioned for graduation that in 1768, a new governor of Virginia, Lord Botetourt, resolved to provide both a push and a pull to the conferring of the Bachelor of Arts degree. His strategy was to put up substantial prize money and medallion awards for commencement week oratory contests. The governor, who surprised both himself and the colonists by his unexpected fondness for the college, insisted on the interesting requirement that only degree candidates were eligible to participate. Batatat's plan was appealing. Several students completed degrees, and the fortunate few who won prizes left the college wiser and wealthier than their less academically ambitious fellows. Historian Phyllis Vine has argued that the ascent of commencement ceremonies as a solemn, prestigious event coincided with the increased recognition by colonial leaders that a college education signaled a young man's entry into a position of power and responsibility in adult life. Reconstructing the academic life of colonial instructors and students is surprisingly difficult because, although many of the elements seem familiar, colonial practices were in fact markedly different from their modern counterparts. For example, one pervasive mode of instruction was classroom recitations. In more advanced courses, lectures on such topics as political economy found favor among both instructors and students. This was probably the clearest link to the remarkable teaching legacy of the universities of the continent and Scotland. At the same time, the colonial colleges did draw from the pedagogy associated with Oxford and Cambridge, reliance on tutors and tutorial sessions. Across all these instructional variations, books and paper remained dear commodities, so most work was oral. Instead of the written examinations familiar to us today, declamation and oratory dominated the educational life of the colonial colleges. Colleges took great pride in their book collections, but these collections remained small and were hardly intended to be a library in the modern sense, with volumes circulating to undergraduates. Even the most prosperous and successful colleges, namely Harvard, Yale, the College of New Jersey, and the College of William and Mary, remained small as to enrollments and limited as to constituency and mission. There is little evidence that any of the colonial colleges ever enrolled more than 100 students in a single year. Many of the colleges expanded their courses of study to include a grammar school, as well as the Bachelor of Arts course. The Bachelor of Arts curriculum did not include fine arts. Some of the college's charters and documents talk about intentions to add advanced studies in, for example, theology, but such plans seldom, if ever, materialized. A fictionalized example of the curricular limits of undergraduate studies may be found in Kenneth Roberts's best-selling historical novel of 1937, Northwest Passage. The narrator is a young man who has been expelled from Harvard and ends up serving as a cartographer with the famous Rogers Rangers in the British Wars against the French and Indians. He was forced to leave Harvard for violating two college regulations. He had first ridiculed college masters and then, to compound this crime of disrespect, had drawn caricatures of the president and instructors. Neither art nor insubordination had a place in the college. The incident, although fictional, is telling because it illustrates the extent to which colonial college life was characterized by perpetual tensions between students and faculty. Despite the glorification of the collegiate way as a haven for youth and a harmonious arrangement for learning, it also was a recipe for conflict characterized by student riots and revolts. These outbursts frequently were triggered by what we would call consumer complaints, about matters ranging from bad food in the dining commons to restrictions on student activities and autonomy. Presidents, assisted by tutors, were constant disciplinarians. Student offenders were subject to a range of punishments. Rustication, for example, meant that a student literally had to go to the country. That is, move his person and possessions off the college property for some stated period of time. A more enduring formal punishment was degradation, the lowering of a student's ranking in his class. The dispensing of academic penalties in the colonial colleges appears to have lacked the humor and goodwill that often characterized student life in the medieval universities. In 14th century Paris, for example, a young scholar found guilty of some offense, such as speaking in the vernacular or missing vespers, might be punished by having to provide wine for masters and fellow students alike. Food and discipline did not exhaust the list of student complaints about college life. In addition to these perennial sources of student malaise, by the mid-18th century, an increasing number of intense, thoughtful students had become restless and critical of the collegiate order and curriculum. This shift was promoted in part by a change in the nature of student misconduct. Whereas in 1720, for example, college students were often boys guilty of childish mischief, by 1770 or thereabouts, an older and more politically savvy generation of students were young men who challenged the principles and premises of their elders. There was a growing student interest in republicanism and ideas outside the academic orthodoxy. Furthermore, a tendency for college officials to be loyal to the unpopular crown escalated the conflicts between students and administration. The elaborate extracurriculum of athletics teams and musical groups, later associated with the collegiate way, were not part of the colonial colleges. There was one important organized activity, however, that did flourish in the latter part of the colonial era: student debating and literary societies. The first such group, Phi Beta Kappa, was founded at William and Mary in 1776. Accounts indicate that this student society met and drafted its charter and bylaws in the Apollo Room of the Raleigh Tavern, not on the college grounds or in a college building. Its spirit of fraternity and political discussion was evident in its provision for welcoming fellow students at other colleges to join in starting their own chapters. Hence, by 1781, undergraduates at Yale and then Harvard had accepted the invitation to establish their own Phi Beta Kappa chapters. In a similar spirit, undergraduates at the College of Rhode Island formed their own Society of the Federal Adelphi to promote literary discourse and scholarly fellowship. Whatever the boundaries of the formal academic course of study, American college students had, from the start, exhibited an interest in political discussion and oratory. When a college happened to be located near its colonial capital, it provided a convenient outlet for the young gentlemen to observe and emulate the leading lawyers and statesmen of the day. The interest in politics and law, both within and beyond the formal course of studies, also signaled another important change in the colonies and the colleges: the gradual but persistent decline of clergy as public leaders, with a drift toward the ascendancy of the lawyer as statesman. Although the social composition of the collegiate student body was relatively homogeneous, there were clear reminders of social class. College rolls listed students not alphabetically, but by family rank. And following the Oxford tradition, academic robes identified socioeconomic position. Commoners, literally those students who dined in common, wore long robes, as distinguished from the short academic robes of servitors, scholarship students who waited on tables. Little wonder, then, that the College of Rhode Island was considered a bit radical in 1769, when the broadside for its commencement exercises bore the headline Nomine Alphabetice Disposita Sunt. Although the college had retained the curricular elitism of Latin, it had made a concession to democracy by publishing the names of its graduating students in alphabetical order. Elsewhere, Harvard and the other colleges continued to list graduates by social rank. College students, from Christian gentleman to gentleman scholar. The preceding account of the collegiate curriculum has naturally included some observations about student life and the composition of the student body. The characteristics of these students reveal a great deal about the purposes of the colleges and about the reasons for colonies being established in the first place. If one looks at the colonies associated with the founding of Harvard, Yale, and Princeton, it is evident that college building was serious business. Congregationalists and Presbyterians, what might be collectively described as Puritans, had definite ideas about collegiate education as part of a large, important social, religious, and political vision. As a group, Puritans had tended to be dissenters in matters of religion, This put them at odds with the crown and often meant that their sons were not eligible to matriculate at the royal universities. From time to time, all Oxford students were required to swear an oath of allegiance to the monarchy and to the Church of England. The former was acceptable to Puritans. The latter was not. The family background of the students at colonial Harvard, Yale, and Princeton tended to be one of mercantile wealth. Prosperous and successful, the Puritan merchants were also devout. They hardly wanted to lose their sons to the depravity of Oxford, where cavaliers and rakes represented the worst of two worlds, indecent behavior combined with Anglican affiliation. From time to time during the lengthy wars of religion and civil wars of the Tudor and Stuart reigns in England, the Puritans might gain a foothold in the universities. As a general rule, though, the two historic universities, especially Oxford, were not hospitable to the Puritan sense of propriety, religion, or education. The Puritans, as college founders, were committed to a rigorous, demanding education of young men who would become Christian gentlemen. They were in line to inherit family commercial enterprises in shipping and selling. The trade-off was that fathers wanted assurance that Congregationalism or Presbyterianism was integral to their sons' daily and eternal life. So the early collegians were sons of privilege, who at the same time were expected to inherit grave responsibilities as leaders and men of influence in a new world where their religion was central and not subject to government or ecclesiastical constraints. Learning was serious, and there was great emphasis placed on the ability to analyze and to be articulate. The crucial ingredient, though, was that all learning ultimately was to coalesce into the values and actions of a Christian gentleman. Who went to the colonial colleges? As the preceding profile suggests, it was a relatively privileged group of young men who were expected to be serious about their studies and their religion. In the early decades, college tuition charges were not prohibitive, and there was some scholarship money available for poor, able youth. However, in the 17th and early 18th centuries, economic conditions in the Massachusetts Bay Colony and Connecticut were austere. Few families could afford the loss of an able-bodied young man from the family farm or business. There were significant differences among the colonies that shaped their respective colleges. South of New England and the Middle Atlantic area, patterns of settlements in Virginia and what was known as the Chesapeake were markedly different from what one would have found in Cambridge or New Haven. By the late 17th century, Virginia had attracted and nurtured a conspicuous planter class, a group whose religious heritage was Anglican and whose ancestors had been large landholders in England, gentry who loved horses and hunting. Not surprisingly, these legacies shaped their notion of colony and college. Plantations and waterways, not townships and roads, defined the colonial world in Tidewater, Virginia, and into the coastal Carolina region. By the mid-18th century, colonial economies in all the regions, ranging from New England to Virginia, enjoyed substantial growth and prosperity. Local communities had each developed their own networks and hierarchies of regional elites and favored families. By about 1750 or so, a college affiliation connoted prestige and high social status. The combination of foregone income and the cost of 2 or 3 years of college tuition and expenses made a college education unaffordable, or at least unappealing, to the vast majority of colonists. Class distinctions within the colony were sharp, and the colleges became increasingly distant from the world and experience of most American families. Clearly, a main purpose of the college was to identify and ratify a colonial elite. The college was a conservative institution that was essential to transmitting a relatively fixed social order. The college's acquisition of this enhanced role in creating a colonial elite was not altogether direct or immediate. According to Phyllis Vine, there was widespread concern among colonial leaders and elders that parents were not always providing the appropriate upbringing for boys who were likely to hold responsible positions when they became adults. One solution was to shift the socialization function away from the family to formal institutions, including grammar schools and, ultimately, the colleges. The colleges, with their concentration of strong male adults, ministers, alumni, government officials, and tutors, were charged with transforming little boys into little men. The historical importance of this enhanced responsibility for colleges is that it marked a significant transition in colonial society. In 1960, Bernard Bailyn's seminal work, Education in the Forming of American Society, prompted a generation of scholars to regard families as the primary agents to educate children both in literacy and in social values. Vine does not reject that perspective, but she concludes that by the early 18th century, the college had supplemented and perhaps replaced the family as the transmitter of social lessons. Given this socializing role, one challenge in accurately analyzing the colonial colleges is to try to look beneath the pejorative modern connotations of elitism. In other words, the remarkable feature of the colonial colleges was not their elite character. Rather, it was the fact that established wealthy families and frugal colonial governments and representatives of the crown put so much discretionary time and resources into trying to impart to their privileged sons a sense of responsibility and public service. It is true that the colonial colleges ratified and perpetuated an elite that would inherit positions of influence in communities. One could also argue that the son of a wealthy Virginia planter or Boston merchant was going to be wealthy and powerful whether he went to college or not. The colonial college was an insurance policy guaranteeing that these favored young men would acquire not only literacy, but also a sense of leadership and service by about their 20th birthday. Democracy, in the modern sense of the word, had little support among colonial leaders, a disparity that remains difficult for us today to accept. The forthright statement of one Virginian sums up the worldview of the young men who typically went to the colonial colleges. "I am an aristocrat. I love liberty. I hate equality." The colleges stepped in to nurture and harness this attitude. King's College described its mission as being to provide to future colonial leaders an education that would enlarge the mind, improve the understanding, polish the whole man, and qualify them to support the brightest characters in all the elevated stations in life. A comparable commitment and justification were conveyed by John Witherspoon in 1772 when he wrote about the founding and mission of the College of New Jersey, later renamed Princeton, to prospective donors in the West Indies. "The children of persons in the higher ranks of life, and especially of those who by their own activity and diligence rise to opulence, have, of all others, the greatest need of an early, prudent, and well-conducted education. The wealth to which they are born becomes often a dangerous temptation, and the station in which they enter upon life requires such duties as those of the finest talents can scarcely be supposed capable of, unless they have been improved and cultivated with the utmost care. Experience shows the use of a liberal education to those who do not wish to live for themselves alone, but would apply their talents to the service of the public and the good of mankind." Did the colonial colleges, in fact, provide their communities with an effective, responsible elite? If one looks at the disproportionate contribution of colonial college alumni to the discussions, debates, and political activity associated with the Revolutionary War and the creation of the United States, it is not unreasonable to give the colleges high marks. College alumni certainly did not monopolize the intellectual and political leadership of the Revolution, but they were a formidable presence. Secular leadership, characterized by the ability to debate in the public forum and to write effectively on matters of political philosophy and law, was no small achievement. The religious emphasis of the college founders raises some questions about collegiate purpose. It is important to dispel the stereotype that the colonial colleges were largely concerned with the education of clergymen. The 17th century document New England's First Fruits, in which Harvard officials stated their dread fear of leaving future generations an unlettered ministry, is frequently cited as proof of Harvard's central commitment to the education of the clergy. In fact, this interpretation is inaccurate because it fails to acknowledge the tone and context of the document. First Fruits was essentially a fundraising broadside, distributed in England as an emotional appeal to potential donors who had little, if any, firsthand knowledge of the New World, let alone its colleges. It emphasized the religious element because college founders knew this commitment would be especially appealing to potential donors. The argument that colonial colleges were devoting a substantial part of their curricula to education of the clergy runs into trouble when one considers that these colleges did not confer divinity degrees, nor did they ordain ministers or priests. In Virginia, for example, although the royally chartered College of William and Mary was loyal to the crown and the Church of England, it would have been impossible for the college to serve as a seminary. Ordination of an Anglican priest had to be carried out by a bishop. Any aspirant would have had to sail back to England for examination and other ecclesiastical requirements. One must also consider the important distinction between collegiate plans and collegiate achievements. The charter for the College of William and Mary referred to a course of study in divinity, an advanced curriculum following the Bachelor of Arts degree, but there is no record that the program was ever implemented. This debate about the relation between the colleges and the ministry was connected to issues of conservative elitism, as discussed earlier. Colonial leaders had an unabashed distrust of an unlearned clergy. Since colleges were the necessary prelude to advanced divinity study and clerical ordination, they were the thin line that protected the colonies from the excesses of populist religion. Harvard College did not ordain ministers, but about half of its graduates eventually entered the clergy. The hope among the governors of the Massachusetts Bay Colony and their counterparts in Connecticut, New Jersey, and other colonies was that college alumni who become clergy would provide an antidote to the threat of uneducated or unlettered revivalist preachers. The cautious, critical, scholarly clerics of Presbyterianism and Congregationalism were concerned that enthusiasm, not reasoned belief, would come to dominate colonial religion and society. What the established clergy did not see was that by the mid-18th century, their influence, even among the traditional college constituencies, had started to erode, with power and prestige becoming increasingly concentrated among an educated secular leadership. There was, in short, a discernible separation of the state from colleges and churches by the end of the colonial era. Religious revivalism and the colonial colleges. A number of prominent historians, including George M. Marsden, have argued that the colleges and universities of today have unwisely ignored the importance of religious belief or abolished its place in the core of higher education. One variation of this lament is that faculty and curricula have been allowed to stray from the original religious and specifically Christian values of the founding fathers. The implication is that reform is in order, that it would be good to restore the religious spirit and emphasis of the original colleges. What is problematic about such revivalism as a reform mandate is that its historical references and antecedents are unclear, and perhaps dubious. First, the founding fathers of the colleges must not be confused with the founding fathers of the nation. As noted earlier, by the time of the Revolutionary War, the collegiate mission had already undergone a discernible shift away from religious orthodoxy toward secular learning and leadership. The leading educational thinkers of the mid-18th century colonial colleges were hardly of a single mind on the primacy of some set of religious beliefs. Benjamin Franklin and Thomas Jefferson, for example, were worlds apart from John Winthrop or Increase Mather. Above all, it is not evident that the values espoused by the Puritan college builders were especially humane or tolerant. The college founders were impatient with, or at best indifferent 2, disagreements within Congregationalism and Presbyterianism, and they were downright hostile toward Anglicanism and Roman Catholicism. A recurring pattern in the progression of college founding is that disputes over religious beliefs were a driving force for groups either to be expelled from an established college or to leave it because they felt that it had fallen from religious grace.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.